K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com. The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. Tune into The Family Factor with Denny C. every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday morning at 5 a.m. as he looks at all the challenges facing the family today. Denny will give you a refreshingly new look at tackling some of the biggest issues. So start your day off on the right foot with Denny C. and The Family Factor, right here on K98Talk.com.
If you like your health care plan, you'll be able to keep your health care plan.
This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had 4 dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you've got a business, you didn't build that.
The feeling most people get when they hear a Barack Obama speech, I felt this thrill going up my leg. I don't have that too often.
Steady.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. Ricky Robinson, host of America Off the Rails, will tackle the important issues facing America today as he tries to keep America from coming off the track. Get ready to hear the truth every Monday through Friday starting at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 Central, and on Saturdays at 12 p.m. Eastern and 11 Central here on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network.
Listening to a radio station where the mighty hosts of heaven sing. Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
If you want to hear the songs of Zion coming from the land of endless spring,
get in touch with God.
Turn your radio on.
Listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Harden. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Harden.
Well, praise the Lord. Welcome again to God's Word of Faith. I'm Richard Harden, And I want to again thank the management and staff of K98Talk.com for allowing me this great opportunity to share God's word with you and throughout the world to many, many other people. In the past, eight programs, I've shared the importance of God's pure word, because God's pure word is Christ. Christ is the wisdom, the power of God. Christ is the pure word of God. And that's why I've named the program this, is because that's what each of us need to be seeking for. And to assist in that, if you go to my website, rahardin.com, I have 6 books, and you can just click on the book tab, go to them, the pictures come up, and then you can get a summary of each one of them, different subjects and everything. Faith, grace, hearing God, promises, and prayer changes things. And then that one on God loved Esau, prayer changes things, choose faith and grace, grace, mercy and charity, and then Jesus. Well, there's a lot of things in our society that are being taught a little different than they really are. And you may not believe this, but there's also some things being taught that are not even in the Bible. So I've tried to point these out in my books, and that's the purpose of having, you know, put them out, because there's so many books out there already, you know, that talk about Jesus and talk about faith and talk about these things. But I did it to try to help clear it up, because when I became a Christian, after being in church for about, 20 years, I grew up in a Baptist children's home. I was in church for 9 years there. Every time the door was open, I knew a lot of God's word. Evidently, it was just enough to make me think that I was okay. But after hearing the messages over and over and over, I knew a lot of God's word. And then when my problems came in the early 30s and in my life and everything, I got so fed up, you know, and just so desperate, I just turned to the Lord and said, God, if you're really real, you know, show me. I don't want this mess I've had before or something like that. And I asked him, you know, to just forgive me my sins. I knew then I was a sinner for sure. At age 9, I just, you know, did that because I knew I did some things bad, but I didn't see it as sin to God. But I did in my 30s there. And when the Lord came in my heart and changed my heart and changed me, it was such a shock to me that it was so different. You know, you can't imagine what it's like to receive the new heart, the new life, and have Christ in your heart if you've never done it before. The changed heart, being born again, like Jesus says, you know, you must be born again. But see, at least I had enough of God's word from all those years of going to church that when my problems did come, I decided to give God first chance and say, Lord, if you're real, show me. Because I want you if you are, and I'll serve you if you are. And just that simple, honest prayer to him. And he changed. He came into my heart and changed me so much. And I want that to happen to each of you listening too. Don't just be religious and carry your Bibles and go to church and do certain things in the right way, supposedly, whatever that right way is, you know, people define. But make sure that you've received the changed heart in your life. And that's what I want to help you do now this morning. But that's why I've written the books and everything, so you have something to kind of sit down and study and look at. They're only about 60, 70 pages long. Easy reading, just like I speak. I don't have any big theological words in there because I couldn't write them anyway and understand them myself probably. But anyway, but I've covered about God's pure word out here. Psalms 138:2, it says that God has exalted his word above all his names. And you know the reason why? Because God and his word are the same. Now see, our names are different. Somebody calls me by my name to get my attention and, you know, identify me and things like this. But God's word and he are the same. That is John chapter 1, verse 1. I shouldn't be so fast there. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God and is God. See, when God speaks, what it is, it's just God manifesting himself is what we say. God spoke to me. God, you know, didn't speak like we do. Now, he sometimes speaks audible and things like this we'd think of, but what it is, it's God himself manifesting a message in our mind. So God and his word are the same. It's just his word indicates that he's manifested some type of intelligent message in our minds that we can understand And we say God spoke to us. Well, one of the problems, or a couple of the problems in getting God's pure word, though, is we have, 150, 200, 300 different denominations. And I've even looked on the computer, and one particular website I came up to said there's over 40,000 groups and denominations around the world that claim to be Christian that have different beliefs. Now, that's a big deal, because which one of them should we go to for God's pure word? See, some say this and some say that, and they all can't be right, because some of them say right opposite. And there's 26 major copies of the Bible. I have a big, thick book here that gives the King James Version, and underneath it, it goes through every phrase in the King James Version, and underneath it, it lists all the different versions that say something different. And it's a big, thick book, and very small print. And it took them 30 years to collect all that information and to go through it. And I'm sure there's probably some new versions out that aren't even included in it now. But these versions, smart people have gone through and studied the original text and stuff, and they've come out with different meanings and stuff. So where do we get God's pure word? And the reason that's so important is, like I said, God's pure word is God himself manifesting himself to us, and that's what we need to be seeking to live by, is what God speaks to us, a living word, Christ. Because when we add stuff to it or take away from it, it's not Christ then, it's just our word. And our word won't save us. Our word won't deliver us from problems. We've got to have God's pure word. Like it says in Proverbs 30:5-6, every word of God is pure, a shield them put their trust in. Add thou not to it, lest he reprove thee and thou be found a liar. See, what it means he's going to reprove us is when he fails to back up what we say, it's going to be obvious that we weren't speaking God's word. We're standing on God's word, claiming a promise for, you know, like some kind of healing or something like this, or some kind of a circumstance. And if we've got his word wrong, he's not, you know, obligated to back it up, and he won't. We got to have his pure word. That's why we need to take the time to put that on the top priority of our list, to seek God's word. So then, after encouraging you to do that, I spoke about God's word of faith and grace. And I'll be sharing a bunch more about that this morning. So I continue here. And then a couple of weeks, I shared 8 ways God spoke to people in the Bible. Now, see, that didn't guarantee us to get answers to prayer. It might have helped some of you understand that God has already been trying to speak to you in ways that you didn't even realize that God spoke. You know, like dreams, visions, or, you know, through ministers in different ways like this. So there's 8 different ways that God spoke to people in the scriptures, and you might want to go back and listen to one of those podcasts. And then the last couple of weeks I've shared about God's mercy, grace, and charity. And these are methods that God comes to us in his love, because God is love. He doesn't send his love to us. God is love, and he comes to us and manifests himself on us, like it says in the Old Testament, in Isaiah 59, verse 21, it says, this is his covenant with the people, his love upon the people, and his words in their mouth. So that was the Old Testament relationship, God coming to people in his love and drawing them, trying to draw them in certain ways, but he wanted a better relationship with that. So the new covenant, not only is God still in mercy, come to us and protect us and guide us and teach us, but he wants to come into our heart. And when we humble ourselves and turn to him, invite him to come in and forgive us of our sins and everything, when he puts his spirit in our heart, now we call that grace. God's grace working in our heart, the spirit of Christ in us, creating in us a new heart, new life, like talked about in the Ezekiel 36:26, where it says, a new heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you. See, when he puts his spirit in us like that, he stays in us, and we become children of God. And that's why Jesus said we must be born again, because, see, we're born into the family of God as children of God. We're not just good people going to church, carrying a Bible. That's what I was for years sometimes, you know, and I thought I was a Christian. I wasn't. But, see, when you receive the Spirit of Christ, the living Word, the creator of the universe, because when God spoke, Christ went forth, the living word, and created light. And then he spoke to Moses. Let's see, Hebrews 11:26 says, Moses esteemed the riches of Christ greater than all the wealth of Egypt. Moses esteemed God's living word manifesting to him greater than all the wealth of Egypt to be in that relationship with God. And when we receive the living God, the living word of God in our heart, and he creates in us a new heart and takes out all those lust and hate and everything, you'll know it. And if you cannot remember when you cried out to the Lord for help to forgive your sins and come into your heart, please do it. Pray and seek until you know you've received the changed heart. And you'll know it, because when an old dirty heart gets cleaned up and then the Spirit of God's love comes in and then he cleans us up and gives us a new heart, you'll know the difference. That's for sure. Now, today I'm going to continue on that because the next several weeks I'm going to be speaking on faith. There's about 3 or 4 major topics in the Bible or scriptures that, are right at the top. And it's hard to say which one's the most important because, we know God is love. And he comes to us in his mercy, one-way love, and his Spirit in our heart, the work of grace, and then charity, the work of grace in a Christian, through a Christian to someone else. God's love. Now, also, one of the other topics is how the devil and Satan tries to trick people, lie to people, block people from receiving God's love and blaming God on so many bad things that happen and stuff, like that, to keep people, from being that concerned. And that's already been set up. See, God has already provided the way for each of us through Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, and, the Spirit of God coming to us. And he's promised to bring everybody to a knowledge of his Spirit. Titus chapter 2, verse 11 says, the grace of God bringeth salvation appeared to all men. Romans 1, 19, chapter 1, verses 19 and 20, it says, the glory of God has shown itself to all men, that we're all without excuse. See, God has already made the way for us even before we were born, and he's done his part in preparing the way. And then he's promised to identify himself to us in a way that we're without excuse. So he's going to do that. But the more we can study about him, though, like his mercy, grace, and charity, and how he speaks and his word and like this, the easier it is for us to recognize it. Now, the reason faith is so important to me is that once I became a Christian, it surprised me that I lived 20-something years going to church, hearing so much of God's word, and I had never received the Spirit of Christ in my heart. And when I did, it was such a great change. How could a person live that long and miss it like I had done, I wish now that I'd received Christ certainly back when I was 9 years old. Man, my teenage years would have been so different. My early 20s and my early marriages and things like this, they would have been so much better, so much less heartbreak, so much less sadness and everything like that. But I didn't. I had a lot of God's word, and thank the Lord in his mercy, he spared me, and I was able to make the choice to turn to him when all those problems came for me. Well, the reason I think faith is probably the one we do need to study the most, because God has already promised to teach us about himself. And the devil is certainly going to do everything he can to try to distract us and lie to us and everything. But our part of it is faith. Hebrews 11:6 says, it's impossible to please God without faith. For he that cometh to God must not only believe that he is, but that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. See, our part in all of this, we have to learn more about, because, there's no promise for him to teach us faith. There's promise that he's going to identify himself to us. God is. He's going to show us his love. He's going to draw us to him and things like this. But what is faith? If there is something that it's impossible for us to please God without, every one of us as Christians should put that subject very close to the top of the list. Sure, we need to study about God. We need to study about Jesus and like this. But we need to certainly be studying about faith, because we can know all about God, all about, you know, mercy, grace, charity, and all these different principles and everything, and, you know, analyze them and talk back and forth and everything. But without faith, it's not going to do us any good, because it says, what is Hebrews 4:2? Hebrews 4:2, it says, "For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them." See, they heard the gospel. And everything. It says, "But the word preached unto them did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it." So see, you can know all about God, all about Jesus, and you can believe too. Belief, you know, you can believe and know that God's real and all this, and that is not salvation. It's how you respond. Yes, sir. Okay. I'm going to a break now for just a second to get something checked out. So I'll be back in just a couple of seconds.
Tune into The Family Factor with Denny C. every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday morning at 5 a.m. as he looks at all the challenges facing the family today. Denny will give you a refreshingly new look at tackling some of the biggest issues. So start your day off on the right foot with Denny C. and The Family Factor, right here on K98Talk.com.
Okay. Well, we're coming back from the break. Something appeared to be going on in the board, but I'm going to just pick right back up and continue talking until. Anyway, faith is our responsibility to respond to God correctly. Now, we can know about God, know about Jesus, but see, when we hear the word of God, the word of salvation, which I just read, and I hope that y'all were able to hear it, "For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto us, but the word preached unto them did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it." So how do we mix it in faith, the gospel that we hear, and all of God's word? In 2 Corinthians 2, 10 through 11, it says that we must forgive others, you know, like that, or we're giving Satan advantage. So how do we respond to that? Well, then we must set ourselves and ask God to help us forgive others. See, we ask for his help. We can't just do things on our own. We need to be turning to him. Philippians 4:6 says, "And be anxious for nothing." When you're anxious about something, pray about it. It says, "Be anxious for nothing, but in all things with prayer and supplication, let your requests be known to God." So see, God wants us to develop a fellowship with him that allows us to just, you know, walk with him and talk with him throughout our daily life. Now, again, Hebrews 11:6, "It's impossible to please God without faith." So since God already promises to bring everyone to a knowledge of him, then our part should be to seek how we should be aligned with him, how we should respond to him. Now, I'm going to be speaking on faith the next several weeks, but right now, I would encourage you, put on the top of your list to study about faith. We should be studying how to fulfill our part and respond correctly to God. Now, in doing this, I'm going to share several scriptures here and then and go into it much deeper and everything. First is Romans 1:17. It says, "The just shall live by faith." Well, in Galatians 3:11, Habakkuk 2:4, Hebrews 10:38, it says that we must live by faith. It's impossible to please God without faith. We receive our salvation. Ephesians 2:8 says, "For by grace are you saved through faith." See, through faith means that our faith must come before we receive God's grace. Now, and the way that works is when we hear that we're a sinner, We hear that Jesus is the answer and that we must call out to God and surrender our heart and life to him. See, faith then, in Romans 10:17, says faith comes by hearing, hearing by word of God. So we've heard from God's word that we're a sinner, Jesus the answer, and that we must respond to him, you know, and ask forgiveness, invite him to come into our heart. We receive the faith when we do that. See, our choice then to mix that gospel with faith is to say, Lord, please forgive me. Come into my heart and save me. See, it's just a simple, honest request of turning your heart and life to the Lord. It's not any, it is a big deal. It is the biggest deal, the biggest choice you'll ever make in your life. But see, you don't have to go out and do a bunch of things. You don't have to, you know, be in front of a preacher. You don't have to be in front of an altar. You don't have to be anywhere. You can be wherever you are right now. Wherever you are is holy ground if you will stand there and say, Lord, forgive me. Come into my heart and forgive me. And I commit my life to you. That's a simple commitment. But in Jeremiah 29:13, says, you shall seek me and find me when you search me with all your heart. See, it just needs to be a honest, heartfelt, you know, turning to the Lord. 2 Corinthians 3:16 says, now the heart of man turns to the Lord, the veil of separation between you and God, says the veil of separation is lifted. See, it's when the heart turns to God, crying out to him. Now faith then cometh by hearing, hearing the word of God, but only if you respond correctly to it. In Psalms 119:9 says, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? And then it says, by taking heed thereto, according to God's word, by taking heed, hearing and hearkening and responding correctly. Now see, when you hear any of God's word and reject or drag your feet, that is not accepting and responding in faith. It's unbelief. That's what unbelief is. And if you look all through the Bible, it says that unbelievers are going to be cast in the lake of fire. It doesn't say doubters, because see, God has promised to bring us out of doubt and to identify himself to everybody. It says the grace of God that bring us salvation appeared to all men. And Romans 1:17-19 says that we're without excuse. The glory of God is just, you know, manifested throughout the heavens and throughout the earth like that. So we're without excuse. So we must make the choice. That's why I think to make a choice, we need to be studying about faith, putting it on top of our list, because you need to make an intelligent choice. Just saying, oh, well, I've heard many preachers say, well, I decided that if Christianity's right, then I'll live and be a good Christian. I'll join the church, things like this. When I die, I'll go to heaven. And if it's not right, well, I've lived a good life, and it, you know, it's been better that way. See, that's not the way you make a choice to, you know, become a Christian. You make a choice to become a Christian by turning to the living God, and he responds by putting his spirit in you, cleaning up your heart, giving you a new heart, a new life, and putting his spirit in you and adopting or engrafting us into the family of God. We're born into the family of God. Now, faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God, but only if we accept and receive what we hear. Now, listen to some of the things that the importance of faith, like I just shared about grace. For by grace are you saved through faith. See, our acceptance of being God's word, then God puts his spirit in us as a result of us calling out to him and asking forgiveness, inviting him to come into our heart. In Hebrews 6:12, it says, we inherit the promises of God by faith. In fact, God wants so much for us to receive the great promises of the, you know, the new covenant. And it says that Jesus is, you know, the mediator of the new covenant that was established on better promises than even in the Old Testament. They had great promises in the Old Testament. But here, God wants so much for the heirs of salvation, us, those who have received Christ in our heart and were born again, joint heirs with Jesus. He double sealed the promises. God has spoken the promises, and then it says, since he can't lie, that he didn't need to do any more, but he did. He spoke the promises, and then he double sealed those promises, swearing by an oath that he wouldn't break them. That's like, you know, I remember back when I was a kid and everything, a lot of times somebody, I'd say something to them, they'd say, oh, that's not right. And I'll say, cross my heart and hope to die it is. See, it was like I was, you know, sealing that word that I said. Well, God did that. He didn't need, you know, double seal of promises. But look in Hebrews 6, chapter 6, verse 18. He double sealed the promises. He wants so much for you and I to experience the blessings of the new covenant. And it's time now for our first break. So I'm going to stop right here. I'll be back in just a couple of minutes to continue here.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. We'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin right here on K98 Talk.
This is Misty, owner of Wax It Studio in Edmond, Oklahoma, and I'm here to talk to you about a skincare product called TheraMedics. TheraMedics has a wonderful line of products from anti-aging to hyperpigmentations all the way to acne. In fact, everyone at some point in our lives is affected by acne. Acne can cause a great deal of embarrassment and anxiety. And in order to prevent and help other people, I have tapped into this wonderful product called TheraMedics. Visit my website at www.prettyskindeep.com. Again, that's www.prettyskindeep.com.
Late Night in the Midlands covers everything. We cover the known and the unknown, the normal and the paranormal, the government lies and the government ties, and even their thrives. We tell what's coming, what's going, and talk about the topics the mainstream media would never dream to touch. We're Late Night in the Midlands, we're independent, and we cover everything and expose the truth one show at a time. Go to www.latenightinthemidlands.com for more details and tune in every weeknight at 9 p.m. until 12 a.m. Eastern Standard Time on K98 Talk.
We believe in the American way, and we built this country called the USA, and we fly our flag because we're proud and free. We're American.
You liked him on Facebook. You followed him on Twitter. The Conservative Curmudgeon Radio Show, a talk show host who's not afraid to say what's on his mind, a live, in-your-ears kind of program, coming to a computer near you, starting in January, every Thursday evening at 8 p.m. Eastern and 7 Central, brought to you by the Spark Radio Network and K98Talk.com. Red, wine, blue is our way of life. When shopping for yourself or that special someone, try a unique touch with White Apartment Studios, where they specialize in fine candles and custom gifts. Visit Stacy R's website at whiteapartment.etsy.com. That's whiteapartment.etsy.com, the world's most vibrant handmade marketplace. And tell her you heard it on K98 Talk. Now back to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin.
Well, Welcome back to God's Pure Word of Faith. I was right in the middle of several scriptures on faith, and I would like to continue them now. And anybody just turned in, Hebrews 11:6 is one of the most important scriptures for us to be concerned about. It says it's impossible to please God without faith. That means in any other way that you try to be pleasing to God, like going to church so much and, you know, never missing, or, you know, being a good person, helping the poor, doing all these things, those will not be pleasing to God without faith. It's impossible to please God without faith. So we need to know what faith is so that we can have the faith and then do those good things to help people. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So when God manifests himself to us in some type of message in our mind or heart, and we recognize it, you know, and God speaks to us, we have to either accept God's word or reject it. The only way to receive the faith then of his words is to accept his words into our heart. Now, Jesus says in John 6:63, my words are spirit and life. See, so when his words are being manifest to us, that's the spirit of God manifesting in our mind, giving us those messages or what we call his words, you know, that we recognize and that we can respond to. When we then respond positively and accept his words into our heart, we're accepting his spirit into our heart. The work of his spirit in our heart is what we call the work of grace. So, for by grace are you saved through faith. When we receive his words of the message of salvation into our heart, those words are alive and they produce the work of grace in us to create in us a new heart, a new life. Now, it's impossible to please God without faith, because see, if you reject those words, you're rejecting the unbelief. That's like the children of Israel. When they came up to the promised land, they all knew it was God's will for them to go into the promised land. They left slavery in Egypt, going to the promised land. They saw all those miracles, God. But when they got up to the Jordan River, they sent out 12 spies to see the best way to cross over the Jordan River, not to decide if they should go there or not, because they all knew it was God's will for them to cross the river. 10 of the spies came back and said, there's giants over there. Where's grasshoppers to them? We can't do that. And then Joshua and Caleb, the two other spies, said, yes, we can. God will give it to us. But the children of Israel, those 10 spies, talked them into rejecting God's will to unbelief. If you look in Hebrews chapter 3, verses 12 through 19, it says, because of an evil heart of unbelief and rejecting the living God. See, rejecting the living God, because his word to them to cross over was his living word that he had spoken to them, Christ. Christ, the living word of God. And they were rejecting that and saying, we can't do it. See, they didn't trust God enough to, after all those miracles he had performed, you know, spreading the Red Sea and everything, so they could walk through it on dry land and all these other things. You know, they should have had so much confidence that God would, you know, take care of them, but they didn't. They didn't trust God enough. Now, see, that's the difference between trust and faith. They didn't trust God enough to take care of them, so they rejected his word to unbelief instead of continuing to accept his word to faith and cross over the Jordan. See, you either accept God's word to faith or you reject it, and you do not have faith until you make the choice. You don't place your faith in God. See, you don't have faith to place, like, you know, you can't pull faith out of your back pocket like money and place it here and place it there and place it here. See, that's a statement you hear so much in Christianity and society that is meaningless. It has nothing to do with faith. When God tells you to, you know, cross over Jordan, see, you don't have anything to place here and place there. If you're going to accept his word to faith, you just accept his words and obey and do what he says. You don't place your faith here and place your faith there. So when people start talking about, you know, placing your faith, that ought to be one clue right there that they don't know what they're talking about. And remember that from now on, because faith is not something you can just place here and there. Faith is acceptance and obedience in your heart and life to God's word that he's spoken to you. And you can't place that anywhere else. You can reject it to unbelief and answer for it at judgment seat of Christ if you're a Christian, or you can accept his word and obey teach that Sunday school class, accept his word and obey and lead that devotional. Work with those young people. See, if you decide that you'd rather not work with those young people, that's unbelief. There's Christianity is filled with people rejecting God's call, and it's unbelief. It's just as serious as before. It won't send you to hell. You know, he won't punish all of us for that because, you know, if it did, there wouldn't be any of us left around. But we're going to have to answer to the judgment seat of Christ when we stand before him and we pass out of this world. He's going to say, why didn't you just trust me enough that I would help you teach that class? See, the children of Israel, why didn't you trust me enough that I'd take care of those giants? See, he's going to say, why didn't you just trust me and let me go with you to help you step by step? Okay, now, so it's impossible to please God without faith. We inherit his promises by faith. There are so many promises going unfulfilled in Christians' lives because they don't even know the promises, let alone trust God for them and everything. There are so many promises about health and things like this. Well, we're John 6:63, scripture says, Jesus says, my words are spirit and they are life. Romans 8:9 says, now, if any man have not the spirit of Christ, there's none of his. So see, we all have the spirit of Christ, the same spirit of Christ that created the universe. God spoke, let there be light. And Christ went forth. He's the creator, creating arm of God. He spoke to Moses. Moses esteemed the riches of Christ greater than all the wealth of Egypt. God spoke, and, you know, Moses responded then. Now, the same Christ lives in our heart, God's living word. And when we, you know, when he identifies himself to us and asks us to do something, we've got to trust that he'll go with us and teach us and guide us and help us do it. Because, you know, there's always a first time for somebody to teach a class, first time for somebody, you know, to lead a devotional, first time for somebody to go, you know, and visit with a sick neighbor or something like this. But see, we trust that God's going to go with us. That's the difference between trust and faith. We have to trust him enough to accept his words that he manifests to us, to accept and obey his words. Now, the gospel only profits us through faith. In Romans 14:23, everything not of faith is sin. If you reject God's call in your life in any way, that's sin or acts of sin for a Christian. It'll be an act of sin. You're rejecting God's call to us. Like, what is it? 2 Timothy 1:9. We all have a special calling. Said he saved us and called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, created in Christ Jesus before the world began. If you're not seeking that holy calling, that's a sinful or wicked thing in your life. To not love the Lord enough, after all he's done for us, to seek his perfect holy calling for you. Now, we may not ever get to his perfect calling. Jesus did. But see, so many of us start out so late in life, we may never reach his perfect holy calling in our life that he had for us when we were born. But yet, we can at least do the best we can to seek now his holy calling in our life for the remainder of our life. And again, the just shall live by faith. When you have problems in this this world, and we're going to have problems, in 1 John 5:4-19, it says, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Now, some people teach it, you know, we got to have the faith of God. We got to have the faith of Jesus. Well, Jesus accepted and obeyed. And he says in John, in different places, he said, I only say what my Father tells me to say. And then he says, I only do what my Father tells me to do. See, that was Jesus' perfect walk of faith. He was only speaking what his Father told him to speak. He was only doing what his Father told him to do. Now, see, he was accepting and obeying his Father's will in his life, a perfect walk of faith. We can't have his faith, but we can have the same faith that God speaks to us and we accept and obey. But we can't have his faith. See, he was the teacher, the author of our faith. He was our example and everything of how to do it, what to do, accept and obey God's word and say what he tells us to say and do what he tells us to do. So like this verse says here, then 1 John 5:4, this is victory that overcomes the world. Even our faith. our faith is the victory that overcomes the world for us, because God's going to speak to us, and then we respond to what he speaks to us. I can't go by what he's told you and everything like that. He has different callings for both of us and all of us. And we need to be seeking him personally instead of trying to copy other people and what they do and how they say it should be and all this. Yeah, we take advice from our Christian brothers and sisters and how God's working in their life. That's why it's so important for us to share testimonies. In fact, was it Romans 12:11? Says, and they overcame him, speaking of the devil, by the blood of the Lamb. See, he's already done it. And by the word of their testimony. As we share testimonies, what God's doing in our life, it's an encouragement to others to seek the Lord and to find out what he wants them to do. But he doesn't want us to do just the exact same things, because he has different callings for each of us. But we seek the Lord till we hear and know that he's speaking to us. Then we accept and obey. In fact, That's been God's call all through the years. In Jeremiah 22:29, God said, "O earth, 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 hear the word of the Lord." It's like he was pleading with them to come back to him, to hear his word and accept and obey and respond, because he had so much. And he says, "These are the thoughts I have for you, that you prosper, that you be in health," and things like this. But see, if we're going to turn, though, and reject his word, like it says in 2 Corinthians 2:10-11, forgive others lest you give Satan advantage. If we're going to reject his word and fail to forgive and refuse to forgive, we're giving Satan advantage in our life. And that's why so many Christians are filling the hospitals across our nation right now. They have unforgiveness to, you know, different family members. They have unforgiveness, you know, just so often, you know, so many people, and they say, well, they don't deserve to be forgiven. What they did to me, they don't deserve it. But see, you're killing yourself when you say that. Your unforgiveness doesn't hurt them in any way, doesn't, you know, cause them any trouble. That's things of the past. Get your life straightened out and get it out of your heart now, because you're giving Satan advantage in your life. And as long as you're doing that, you're out of fellowship with God. You're going to miss getting the answers to prayer. Even like in, let's see, what is it? 1 Peter 3:7, where it says, husbands, dwell with your wives according to knowledge as being joint heirs of grace of life, lest your prayers be hindered. Relationships like that between husbands and wives and parents and children and just relationships in every area of our life, you know, go the extra mile, be a blessing to people, pray for those that despitefully use you. See, and if you fail to go by God's word, see, you're giving Satan advantage in those circumstances where you're failing to go by God's word. That's why we all need to be reading the scripture and finding out how God wants us to respond in these different situations. Instead of just fighting like the people of the world and everything, I'm going to get my way, I'm going to give them a piece of my mind and stuff like this, you know. No, pray and let the Lord handle it and go according to scripture, okay. Now, victory over the world, even our faith, acceptance and obedience to God's word. Now, there's a scripture right along with that, 1 John 5:19, that probably most people in our society haven't heard or don't believe. It's almost like it's been cut out of the Bible and everything like that. But you know what it says? It says the devil has control of this world. Now, you say, wait a minute, that can't be. The devil can't be in control of this world. Jesus says in Matthew 28:18, all power in heaven and earth is given unto me. So how can Jesus have all power in heaven and earth and the devil be in control? Very simply, just what I was explaining. If you fail to forgive someone, you're giving the devil control in your life. If you hold on to that unforgiveness, because see, God's will is for you to forgive. So if you're rejecting God's will, you're in unbelief and you're giving Satan advantage in your life and you're failing to get answers to prayer at that time. Now, God in his mercy sometimes will override this and protect us, but we can't depend on God's mercy every time. We need to be searching the scriptures and walking by faith. It says the just shall live by faith. That means by studying and finding God's word, finding God's will. And then throughout the daytime, then as the Holy Spirit then speaks to us and brings those scriptures back to mind, tells us how to, respond in this situation, how to respond in that situation. We should be growing to where we can hear his voice throughout the daytime, speaking to us, telling us what to do. because John 10:10 says, my sheep hear my voice, all others they'll flee. See, so each of us have a responsibility of seeking through his word and learning to hear his voice and responding to him by faith. The just shall live by faith. Okay, so now that's how the devil has control in this world. Because see, most of the people in our society right now in the United States, most of the people don't want to have anything to do with God's word. They want to take everything that has to do with God, well, God of the Bible, that is, out of schools, out of public places, all of his stuff. And see, just, and that's exactly opposite what we need to be doing. We need to be having these things to remind us throughout the daytime, you know, of God and his love and his word and everything. But most people don't even care about God's word in our society. And then those of us that are Christians, we need to know more of his word so he can lead and guide us to respond correctly during the daytime and live by faith and acceptance and obedience to his word. Just going to church, carrying your Bible, hearing a 30-minute message on Sunday is not going to be the food you need for 7 days after that, all through the 7 days like this. You need to be studying your word daily. Now, Christ, he is the power of God. So when we have his living word in our hearts and we respond to his living word in our heart and we speak it, Christ goes forth and he has the power of God just as powerful when he is living in and through us as when God spoke, let there be light. See, Christ is not different values of strength or power. He is the power of the living God, Christ living in us. And it also says in 1 Corinthians 2:5, that we have faith in the power of God, that we have our faith, you know, that we've accepted his word, Christ in us. And that's when we'll see things happening in our life that are, you know, when the devil comes against us, the Spirit of God will, you know, step in, and take over. If we're speaking God's word, you know, like in, what is it? Proverbs 35:6 again says, every word of God is pure, a shield and put their trust in it. But see, we got to have his pure word. I said, a shield them, put their trust in. Add thou not to it, lest he reprove thee, now be found a liar. We can be doing all kind of things, you know, like it says, you know, resist the devil and resist here and fight here and do this. And, you know, put on the whole armor of God and you say all those things and everything and you got his armor on, you think, and the devil still, you know, just tearing you up. But see, it's got to be more than just words like that. It's got to be in your heart, submission to God. For an example, when it says down here in Ephesians 6:16, the shield of faith to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, the shield of faith. That says all the fiery darts of the wicked. Are the darts of the wicked getting through to you? Your shield may have some holes in. What I mean by that is there may be some things that, about God, like you holding unforgiveness over here, or you might be envious of the person that's singing the most solos in church. You know, you say, well, I would like to sing more. They let her sing all the time, or they let him sing all the time like that. You know, they might be envious like that. Where there's envying and strife, there's confusion and every evil work. See, confusion and strife and envy are signs that the devil's present in his evil works in people's lives and everything. So, you know, you got to be careful here. No, but see, all these wicked, fiery darts of the devil, it rains on the just and the unjust, but with this shield around us and everything, we shouldn't be getting as wet as the unjust. Or like, for an example, in the, what is it, Psalms 34:7, it says, the angel of the Lord encamps around about them that fear him and delivers them. And see, if you aren't being delivered, if all these fiery darts aren't being quenched, you probably have holes in your shield, that a misunderstanding. You know, just because you're so sincere in what you believe, God doesn't back it up if it's wrong. You need to be seeking for God's pure word and saying, Lord, help me. Like that one man said, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. You know, help me to receive. God's promises are so great, it's hard to receive them. Like just John 15:7 is really the only promise we need throughout the scriptures for health, prosperity, anything you need. John 15:7, Jesus says, if ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ask what you will and it shall be done. See, anything comes against you, all you got to do is say, Lord, take that away. Heal me. Do this or whatever you don't like this. if his word is abiding in you. Same scriptures reworded in 1 John 3:22. It says, and whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. See, that's saying the same thing. Whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we obey his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And now, what is it pleasing in his sight? It's impossible to please God without faith. That means we're accepting and obeying his word to teach classes, to work with neighbors, to do this, to, you know, we're accepting and obeying his word as we go along. Whatsoever we ask, we receive him, because we, you know, obey his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And it's impossible to be pleasing without God, because Romans 14:23 again says, everything not of faith is sin. The just shall live by faith. And that's how the devil has control in our society. And that's how come, you know, we're being overrun by the, you know, Muslims and all this other stuff, ACLU in our society, because the Christian community, God is not backing up in our society. There's not supposed to be 200 or 300 denominations. There's supposed to be one group of born again Christians seeking and serving the Lord. Look in, 1 Corinthians 3:1-3. And because of two divisions of division in the church, some say I'm Paulus, some say I'm a Paul. He says you're babes in Christ because you're in this division. And look at our society, 200 or 300 different denominations, everything like this. Our society is babes in Christ. And I mentioned that before and everything. These preachers and everything, PhDs, Dr. So-and-so and Dr. So-and-so. What are they doctors in? Well, Baptist PhDs studied the Baptist way to interpret the Bible. Catholic PhDs studied the way Catholics interpret the Bible. You know, and Church of Christ and Nazarene and Methodist and all like this. See, they haven't really studied God's pure word. They're studying how their denomination interprets God's word. So we don't have God's pure word being taught in our society. And a lot of people are going to be so misled and go to hell, because you can see that our hospitals are filled. Christians should have the best health in the country. We got the best health plan back here in, let's see, I think it was Exodus where, God told him, he said, if you'll serve me with joy and happiness, he said, I'll bless your bread, bless your water, and I'll take sickness away from the midst of thee. That was an Old Testament promise to him. And under the new covenant, we have better promises. But see, they only come to us through faith. You got to know the promises, and you got to do your part, accept and obey God's word to faith. You got to trust him enough to give him a chance. Now, there are some other things being taught about faith, like you'll hear people say, well, like I mentioned before, place your faith. You don't have faith that you can just place it here and here. Now, what they should be saying is place your confidence in God. Place your trust in God. You know, like the children of Israel, if they had trusted God enough that he would take care of them crossing the Jordan. But see, our society has changed everything because it sounds so much better to say faith. But place your confidence in God. Place your trust in God. And he will back it up. Now, in Romans 12:3, there's a scripture that says that God has dealt to every man a measure of faith. But if you look at Romans 12, Apostle Paul was writing to Christians about the gifts of the Spirit. That's a gifts of the Spirit chapter, how God works through his people, you know, in charity or in works of the gifts of the Spirit or working his faith by love. Romans 12 starts, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, you know, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to the Lord. And then the second verse is, be not conformed to this world, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove that is the perfect will of God. See, he's writing to Christians. And all Christians have to have faith, because all Christians have to make a personal choice to ask God's forgiveness for their sins and invite Jesus to come in their heart and commit their life to him. So when person responds to faith, to God's word, and says, Lord, please forgive me, come into my heart and save me. Then, see, his Spirit comes into our heart, creates a new heart and new life, and for by grace are you saved then through your acts of faith. So there is something we have to do for salvation. people say, oh, well, you know, there's nothing you can do. You can't earn it and all this. That's not right. You've got to humble yourself to God's word. You're a sinner that Jesus answered. And when you humble yourself, cry out to God and say, Lord, please forgive me. Come into my heart. Now, give my life to you. See, there's something you got to do, and that's what you got to do. You got to humble yourself to God, invite him to come in. He won't come in uninvited. Then when he comes in, that's a work of grace in for salvation. So all Christians do have faith. Like Romans 12:3, God has dealt us all a measure of faith when we've invited Christ to come into our heart. Now listen to same Paul in 2 Thessalonians 3:2. He's asking the disciples and others to pray for him. He said, pray for us that we'd be delivered from evil and wicked men in whom is no faith. See, he's saying there's people that don't have faith. But in Romans 12:3, he said God dealt to all men a measure of faith. But he was talking about all Christians in Romans 12:3. And now down here in 2 Thessalonians 3:2, he says, evil and wicked men in whom is no faith. These are the evil and wicked people who have rejected God's word, rejected it. So now we're going to take a short break, and I'll come right back, and we'll continue on concepts of faith.
Visit Richard's website at raharden.com. That's the World Wide Web at raharden.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Harden to see and purchase his books. We'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Harden right here on K98 Talk. K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com.
This is Misty, owner of Wax It Studio in Edmond, Oklahoma, and I'm here to talk to you about a skincare product called Theramedics. Theramedics has a wonderful line of products from anti-aging to hyperpigmentations all the way to acne. In fact, everyone at some point in our lives is affected by acne. Acne can cause a great deal of embarrassment and anxiety. And in order to prevent and help other people, I have tapped into this wonderful product called Theramedics. Visit my website at www.prettyskindeep.com. Again, that's www.prettyskindeep.com.
Late Night in the Midlands covers everything. We cover the known and the unknown, the normal and the paranormal, the government lies and the government ties, and even their thrives. We tell what's coming, what's going, and talk about the topics the mainstream media would never dream to touch. We're Late Night in the Midlands, we're independent, and we cover everything and expose the truth one show at a time. Go to www.latenightinthemidlands.com for more details and tune in every weeknight at 9 p.m. until 12 a.m. Eastern Standard Time on K98 Talk.
We believe in the American way, and we built this country called the USA, and we fly our flag because we're proud and free. We're American.
You liked him on Facebook. You followed him on Twitter. The Conservative Curmudgeon Radio Show, a talk show host who's not afraid to say what's on his mind, a live, in-your-ears kind of program, coming to a computer near you, starting in January, every Thursday evening at 8 p.m. Eastern and 7 Central brought to you by the Spark Radio Network and K98Talk.com. When shopping for yourself or that special someone, try a unique touch with White Apartment Studios, where they specialize in fine candles and custom gifts. Visit Stacy R's website at whiteapartment.etsy.com. That's whiteapartment.etsy.com, the world's most vibrant handmade marketplace. And tell her you heard it on K98Talk.com. The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
With God.
Get in touch with God.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
Now back to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Harden.
Welcome back. Praise the Lord. I was sharing right before the break about Romans chapter 12, verse 3. And I want to read that to you because rather than me just tell you it's there, I want you to hear that it's there. It may be a while before you get a chance to read it. Romans 12, 3, Apostle Paul talking to Christians now. This is the gifts of the Spirit chapter. It says, "For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith." Now see, all of us are at different levels of faith. Like many of you have received more of God's word into your heart than I have. But see, our level of faith depends on how much of God's living word we received into our heart. Somebody just becoming a Christian may not have much of God's living word in their heart. See, at different levels of faith. And he's saying, you know, only, you know, serve here and not to think more highly of yourself, but to think soberly according as God has dealt to every man a measure of faith. And he's saying, you know, kind of serve the Lord at the level that you are, you know, like that. Now, he's not saying that every person is born with faith, because then he's talking to Christians and all Christians must have faith, but grace are we saved through faith. So if you don't have any faith as a Christian, you're not a Christian. You know, you haven't received grace in, because we receive the spirit of those words into our heart, the work of grace. Now, in 2 Thessalonians, Apostle Paul is talking to these people. And in 2 Thessalonians 3:2, he says, well, in verse 1, I'll start there. "Finally, brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified, even as it is with you." In verse 2, "and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for all men have not faith." Now see, he's not contradicting himself over there. He's talking about these ungodly people who have not received any of God's word in their heart, do not have faith. You only have faith if you've responded positively and received God's word into your heart, and then you receive the work of grace in your heart from the spirit of those words. Now, to go along with that, if, you know, that's what why a concordance is so good, you know, to study different subjects. A concordance now is a big book. It's based on King James, because the King James was so popular through the years and took them a long time. But every word in the King James Bible is in that book. Not the new versions, but, you know, the older standard versions is in the book called Concordance. So if you want to study faith, just get a concordance and look up the word faith, and it'll give you every scripture that the word faith is used in. And guess what? If you look up the word faith, And the reason I'm saying this is because so many, many people across our nation, ministers and everything, teach that everybody has faith. Just place your faith here, place your faith there. But if you look up in accordance, everywhere the word faith is used, the first time you'll find when you see in there, it'll have a verse that says Deuteronomy 32:20. You know what Deuteronomy 32:20 says? It was God. He must have been the one that introduced the word or invented the word faith. But let's see, Deuteronomy 32:20 tells us what God thinks about it. Let me find it here real quick. Got to get that in for you. 32:20. God was talking about his people. And he says, and God said, I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end shall be. For they are a very forward generation, children in whom is no faith. See, they were so faithless. They didn't have his word. They weren't obeying and accepting his word. And he said, I'll hide my face and just see what comes of them. He said, they're such a terrible generation, a forward generation in whom is no faith. See, they haven't received any of his word. Now, so if a person looks up the word faith in a concordance, the first word of faith used in the Bible is God himself saying that his children had no faith. So how could anybody teach then that everybody has faith? And all of that, look up what Jesus says in Mark chapter 4, verse 40, when the storm came and he was asleep on the back of the boat and the disciples came to him and said, Master, we perish. He had done told them we're going to go across. They didn't accept his word, though. They said, Master, we perish. He stood up and said, peace be still. The winds and the waves stop. See, that's one thing in society. Everything in our world obeys God's word except mankind. Mankind is the only one that has a choice to reject God's word. Animals obey God's word. Trees obey God's word. And when Jesus cursed that tree and told it to die, it died. The winds and the waves said, peace be still. They had to be still. See, everything responds positively to God's word except people. Now, but anyway, when he spoke to winds and waves and they calmed themselves, and then he turned to the disciples and you know what he said? Why do you have no faith? He didn't say have little faith. Some of the versions put little faith, but he says, why do you have no faith? See, so even good people can have no faith in certain areas. That's why some people, for prosperity, they just reject the prosperity message. All those people just teach, you know, money and money and money. But Abraham was prosperous. Most of God's people throughout the scriptures were prosperous and everything. And he wants us to have enough to meet our needs and overflow and help meet other people's needs. See, that's what he wants us to do with our prosperity is share and help others. But now, so everybody does not have faith. And the way you can identify it is when people say, place your faith here. Place your faith in Christ. Place your faith in Jesus. That sounds good. But see, it's not true. You don't have anything you just place here and there except your confidence. You can place your confidence. You can place your trust, but not faith. So get the words right and don't confuse people. When we're sharing, the devil's going to do everything he can to twist our words around and keep people from accepting God. Unless we're careful. Now, as teachers, we should try to be careful and speak the true word of God. We're ambassadors for Christ. Ambassadors have no right to change God's word. We should be seeking his pure word. Now, for a new Christian or, you know, somebody that just hasn't been that far along and everything like that, God will bless enthusiasm sometimes and, you know, and maybe work in people's lives just because of the joy of their testimony of what God's done for them and everything. But he doesn't expect us to be like that. Now, we don't have to know these words perfect either, like faith and grace and mercy, to become a Christian. All we have to do is just turn our hearts to the Lord and cry out. But see, once we become a Christian, we're supposed to be good and faithful witnesses to our Heavenly Father who saved us and called us to a holy calling. That's our responsibility. It's mine. It's yours. Not just your preacher. Now, some of you women out there, you think, well, my husband's, you know, been a deacon 30, 40 years. I don't need to do anything. Yes, you do. You have responsibility yourself personally to be witnessing and sharing God's love. Deacons, you do too. Just because you give your money and you pay the preacher to go to hospital and visit sick people, you're supposed to be going to. See, just giving our money to a group of people and paying them to do what God has asked us to do, we're going to have to answer for it to the judgment seat of Christ. He expects each one of us to be personal witnesses of him and his love in our heart. He cared for us so much he died for us. Can't we care for him enough to go for him? He don't want people to die for him. He died for us. He wants people with the guts to live for him. That means you got to, you know, go down to that neighbor and say, I came down. I want to pray for you. I want to pray with you. And like this. And let them know you're a Christian. Let them know that your God, you know, can hear and answer prayers. And you pray with them then, and they hear your prayer. And then when they start getting their answer to prayer, they'll say, hey, you know, that's right. You know, he prayed and I got well. See, you got to give God a chance to work in your life through you to show others what God will do to bless them. Like Psalm 67, the Jews were supposed to have been God's blessing here on earth. That's what he called Abraham out. It's supposed to be a land of priests, a nation of priests to all the rest of the world. Now, they had their own Levites with their priests, but they were supposed to have been God's representative to the whole world. In fact, if you look in 1 Kings chapter 8 at the promises that Solomon and God made, you know, covenant that they made in the establishment of the new big temple that Solomon built. You know, it says, if you come before the temple and humble yourself and pray and seek my face, whatever your problem is, whether it's a famine, whether it's, you know, enemy coming against you, or even if I'm punishing you, God says, I'll hear and answer your prayer, and I'll answer and meet all your needs if you'll just humble yourself and come before the temple. Down below that, in one of the verses, as a little verse, it says, and to any stranger from any far country on the earth, any stranger that will come before the temple and humble themselves and call out to me, I will hear and answer them too. See, so the temple wasn't just for the Jews. The temple was for everybody on earth. And that's the way God's salvation is today, for everybody on earth. We're supposed to be his ambassadors to the world. And each one of us personally is supposed to be an ambassador and a priest to everybody you meet today, everybody I meet today. We're their priest, sharing God's love and God's word to them, accepting his word by faith and allowing his spirit to work through us by love, faith that worketh by love. See, when we share with someone else, it should be God's word then working through us, faith by love. Now, you could say, oh, well, I'll teach that class. You know, okay, I'll teach that class. Go grumbling. And then see, God wouldn't be going with you. So you'd just be going by yourself and nothing would happen. So if you're going to go, say, Lord, help me to have the right attitude. You know, Jonah didn't do that. Jonah went with the wrong attitude, but God loved those people so much, he still blessed them. But anyway, God wants us to go with the right attitude to help draw them to us. And the Jews, like I said, were supposed to have been God's priest on earth. And during the Old Testament time, we are the priest, the Christians are the priest on earth today. We're a nation of priests, a royal priesthood and everything. But like in Psalm 67, where David says, God be merciful and bless us and cause your face to shine upon us. That sounds kind of selfish. Bless us and cause your face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving health among all the nations. Let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. Then shall the earth receive the blessings, and God, even our God, will bless us. See, so let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. It wasn't selfish. That's what God wants to do with us. He wants to bless us, his children, so that others will know that he is a living God that loves us. And he didn't create 9/11. He didn't create all these floods and everything like that and everything. He allowed them to happen, but he didn't create them. He allowed them to happen because of evil people not turning to him in prayer and not turning to him with their lives. And we have so many denominations in our country and everything like that are not living by God's pure word. They're living by their denominational word. Now, all people do not have faith. We must have the shield of God's pure word to quench the fiery darts of the wicked. Faith that worketh by love. When God speaks and asks us to do something, if we don't want to do it, he knows that. Just pray and say, Lord, please help me. I know it's your will, and I know, you know, it'll be better for me and all others, but help me. See, God will bless a mustard seed of faith. That is, if you've heard from him and you will go and just, even if you have to struggle to go and do with the right attitude and everything, he'll bless it. But he won't bless an ounce of doubt, because see, an ounce of doubt means you haven't heard from God yet. You're just feeling wooed, or you're just feeling, you know, that God's, you know, doing this, you know, nudging me or something like that. You know, unless you can say, God told me this, you can't say something by faith, because you've got to know it's God speaking to you. Faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God, not something that just sounds good, not something that all your friends are doing in church or something like this. To live by faith is you're living by God speaking to you. You've got to learn like those, how God speaks by praying, to see how he responds back to you and how he speaks to you in that. It's, you know, not mystical or something like that. When you read the scriptures and then during the daytime, something happens, and then all of a sudden the Holy Spirit brings that scripture back to you and tells you what to do. See, it's God speaking to you, but you got to have his scriptures in you for him to be able to do that. See, so God will bless a mustard seed of faith, but not an ounce of doubt, because if you're in doubt about something, you still do not know God's word, God's will, and you haven't taken time to seek him on your knees to find out his word or will. Now, I want to share with you a little diagram. I hope I can get a picture developed in your mind. You know, that's one of the greatest things about communication problems, whether you're writing or speaking or whatever, is I have an image in my mind that I want to convey to you, and I would hope that you get the same image in your mind that I do. See, now that would be perfect communication there between us if I was able to do that. But when I first became a Christian, I knew Christ in my heart. I knew he had changed my heart so much, because he took some hate out of my heart, and I hated some people so bad I was going to even try to hurt them bad. Anyway, I didn't care anything for the Bible for, you know, I'd read one verse a week so I could, you know, check off at church that I'd read my Bible. And that's ridiculous. Now, that should have been a clue to me then. I wasn't a Christian, but it didn't. But when I received Christ in my heart and I picked up my first Bible and looked at it, started reading it, I couldn't put it down hardly. It came alive to me. And not only that, just I looked in the refrigerator and saw it alcohol after 2 or 3 days. I hadn't seen it. I said, wow, I hadn't even thought about that. And I'd been living on it. So I just took it over the sink and dumped it out. I was tempted to take that first swallow just to see what it still tastes like. But there was some voice in me that said, no, don't. Just throw it away. I did. And that was it. And just so many things, like my attitude toward my rich, fancy cars, new town car, special ordered, fancy paint, all this stuff, prettiest car in town. I had a little red and white 57 Thunderbird with a white clip off top. Well, that thing would squeal the tires and all gears and everything. That was my pride and joy, that and that Continental. But when I looked out that window one day, God spoke to me, you need family cars. And that's right. I need family cars, you know. Sold them and got family cars. Things like that. See, attitudes in me changed so much. I wasn't doing it just to prove to somebody or just to, you know, show somebody, you know, hey, how holy I am now and everything. I wanted family cars. That's what I wanted. And things like this. But when that hate left my heart for these guys that I knew, and God put that love in me, I wanted them to know what I'd found. Now, when that happened to me, and I started sharing with others about the Lord, I didn't know what to share with them when I first started, except just get your Bible out and start reading in Proverbs and Psalms and just read it to enjoy between you and the Lord. And if you need to understand something, don't worry about it. God will give you understanding, because he knows what they mean. But if he doesn't give you understanding, just enjoy it and keep on going. Just keep reading. Don't, you know, feel, you know, stupid, or don't feel like you need to understand everything you read right at first. Just God will give you understanding of what you need. Just get your Bible out and start reading it and enjoying it between you and him. That's what I would tell people. And then I'd start seeing those verses like I shared with you a while ago. Everything not of faith is sin. I said, I wonder if I got faith. And you say, the promises come to you, faith. And I'd say, wow, I wonder if I got faith. And I started, you know, really wondering about faith and everything. And it bothered me. It got to bother me more and more because I couldn't get it out of my mind. Because see, here I was just enjoying the Lord and everything, and just, you know, getting answers to prayer and so many blessings. And, you know, that should have been obvious enough to me, but I had no idea, you know, really what faith was, except that, well, I must have it because of the way God's working in my life. But I started looking through the scriptures and everything. Let me give you a rundown here. We'll have to take a break in a few minutes, but now I'm going to give you a little rundown. If you have a problem, you're in what we call doubt. You're in doubt. And naturally, you have a hope. You hope to get out of that problem. See, your hope is developed by whatever your problem is or your concern. You're in doubt. Now, if your car breaks down or something like that, or something in the kitchen for you women breaks down, you know, like that, your first question would be, well, what's wrong? You're going to investigate. You get out of the car, you lift the hood, you look at this, the steam coming, is it from a water hose that's popped, or is it from a water pump or something that's leaking or whatever like this? So you start investigating. You start seeking to obtain knowledge to let you know what to do. And now that's the Lord, you know. At first, if you don't know what a scripture means, or if you don't know something else that has to do with the Lord, or even what the Lord would have you do in teaching that class, have you got a problem and what should I do about it? See, you're in doubt if you got more than one possibility. So what do you do when you're in doubt? You set yourself to seek the Lord. In 2 Chronicles 12:14, it said Rehoboam, Solomon's son, said he did evil because he did not set his heart to seek the Lord. See, now when we got a problem and we don't know what to do, it's evil for us to turn other places. Like some people turn to alcohol, especially, you know, struggling with sin. We recognize that we're a sinner, they turn to alcohol to forget it, or, you know, something like that. Or turn to, you know, power, trying to make more money. There's all kind of ways that people turn to escape that emptiness in their heart. In Psalms, it says all of our hearts are created alike. See, he's formed all of us with a void that can only be filled by his Spirit. You can turn, and, you know, that void starts getting anxious in a person's heart, and they start seeking ways to be happy and seeking ways to be fulfilled. And I point out to people when I talk with them like that, Psalm 16:11 says, thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. Seeking God's presence, seeking that holy calling he has for us, is the only thing you can do to help that feeling in your heart. Because see, God is going to be in your heart then, helping you and giving you that joy that you're on the right path. You cannot be prepared to die until you know you're on the right path with the Lord and you've made peace with him in your heart. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. So when you got a problem, instead of turning to alcohol, power, money, sex, or all these other things of the flesh, turn to the Lord. Set yourself to seek the Lord for what your problem is. Is it about which school to attend, which job to take, which house to buy? You know, just pray and say, Lord, please help me to know now which one, you know. Give me some kind of indication, you know. Walk with him daily. He wants to be a part of it because he knows where you need to live. In fact, God is so pleased when people will turn to him in a problem. You look in Lamentations 3:25 and it says, God is good to those that seek him. So see, he'll be good to you and then he'll give you an answer. So you get a double blessing. Yeah, so set yourself to seek the Lord. Matthew 7:7. Seeking you shall find. Asking you shall receive. Seeking you shall find. Knock and the door be open. He that asketh receiveth. He that seeketh findeth. He that knocketh, the door is open unto him. Trust him. And in Matthew 7:11. If ye then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit and good things to those that ask him? See, he wants us to turn to him. Then Philippians 4:6 is one of the great scriptures on prayer too. Be anxious for nothing. When the first time you recognize being anxious or something, it says, be anxious for nothing, but in all things with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. Don't wait till the doctors all give up and just quit and everything. Start at the beginning. If somebody, you start feeling bad, pray. You know, turn to the Lord right at the beginning. Don't wait until you get so sick and everything. They're having to haul you off in a, you know, a gurney or whatever they call it like that, you know, hauling you off like that. Well, it looks like it's time for our last break. So I will take a break now and come back in just a couple of minutes.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. Visit Richard. Now back to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard. We'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin right here on K98 Talk.
If you like your health care plan, you'll be able to keep your health care plan.
This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had 4 dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you've got a business, you didn't build that.
The feeling most people get when they hear a Barack Obama speech, Mike, I felt this thrill going up my leg. I don't have that too often.
Steady.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. Ricky Robinson, host of America Off the Rails, will tackle the important issues facing America today as he tries to keep America from coming off the track. Get ready to hear the truth every Monday through Friday starting at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 Central, and on Saturdays at 12 p.m. Eastern and 11 Central here on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network. Tune into The Family Factor with Denny C. every Monday, Wednesday.